Max bought an old Land Rover, but we don't know what series it is. If we stand a chance of making any money, we need to find out what we're dealing with and return this converted collectible back to its authentic self.
The purists go round these things with a fine-tooth comb, a magnifying glass and a tape measure, just making sure that everything is exactly as it should be. And by that, I mean original. Get one of those details wrong or take a shortcut by using the wrong nuts and bolts or screws and you can genuinely wipe a huge amount of money off the car's value. My biggest challenge with this car is not knowing at this point exactly how much of it is authentic Series 1 and how much of it is, well, goodness knows what else. So the first job is going to be to strip it down and find the answer to that question.
I'm potentially opening up a big can of worms here. If lots of these parts prove not to be genuine, then it could cost us a fortune to get this car back to factory spec.
The great thing about these cars is they're just so simple and everything comes apart really easily.
These two part doors are definitely genuine. The doors on later Land Rovers consist of a single panel, so that's a relief. If we'd had to buy a pair of second-hand Series 1 doors, that could have set us back up to £800. Unfortunately, there's something about the wheels that doesn't ring true.
Now, when Mike brought this car back, I thought the wheel was sitting a little bit far out from the chassis, and I actually thought it was probably the axle that was responsible for that, but looking at it now, it might even be that it's the wheel itself. That looks a bit deeper than I think it should. And, in fact, it's got the size of the wheel imprinted on it itself, there.
That's going to require some further investigation.
I need to make sure that this Land Rover's chassis is structurally sound, but examining it might also help to unlock some of the mysteries around this car's past.
Removing the tub's a two-person job, so I've asked one of the mechanics from the garage next door to give us a hand.
Nathan, give us a hand, mate. Okay. We're ready to lift this off. See what we got underneath. Ready?
Yep.
So here it is, the skeleton of our Series 1 and where all that famous rugged strength comes from. There's not a lot to it, is it? It's a basic ladder chassis that connects the rear axle to the front axle and everything else just bolts to that. What we don't yet know is exactly which year this is or whether all the components that are on it are correct. So I've downloaded some information off the internet which should help me to narrow down exactly that.
The dominant indicator that this Land Rover will be a Series 1 will be if the wheelbase measures somewhere between 80 to 86 inches. So, let's see what series we're dealing with.
86 inches. Now, that narrows down exactly when this was made, because in 1953, they changed from an 80-inch wheelbase to 86, but then in 1956, to accommodate a diesel engine, it grew longer to 88 inches, even on a Series 1. So we now know that we're in that three-year window between 1956 and 1953. Brilliant.
This means I'm 99% sure that our car's a Series 1, but I'm not convinced about that rear axle. While I've got my tape measure out, I just want to make sure.
Here we go. It's 1,200 millimetres. That confirms, then, that this is a Series 2 rear axle in our Series 1 Land Rover, and that will never do.
Britpart have been keeping old Landys on the road for over 35 years. The authentic rear axle they found us is unfortunately worn and damaged from being left outside for over a decade. So, it needs stripping down and refurbishing, and that job requires specialist tools that I don't have, which is another reason I've made the long trip to Shropshire.
Hiya.
Hi, I'm Elvis. I think I'm here after that.
Mike sent you, yeah?
He did, indeed.
Yeah, there it is. Help yourself.
Thank you very much. Blimey, that's been sat around for a while. Oh, it still turns, though. That's a bonus. Oh, look at that. Absolutely full of oil. There is no way that those brakes are stopping anything looking like that. It's disgusting. The whole thing has got to be stripped down. Those brake shoes need changing. It's going to be a messy job.
With the housing off, I can undo the bolts that hold the brake shoes to the drum. Next, I use a tool made out of an old coat hanger to remove the hard-to-reach spring. and with the brake shoes out of the way, I can remove the brake cylinder.
Now, we're dealing with a very rare vehicle here, so my instinct is always to refurbish rather than replace parts wherever possible. I mean, this brake cylinder, for example, I would have loved to have replaced the seals in here if they're available, but it's heavily corroded. The brake nipple itself has now sheared off in there, and that could be a nightmare to get out, so I think I'm probably going to have to replace that.
I need to inspect the wheel bearing, but I can't get to it because it's retained firmly inside the hub by a metal collar. The only way to remove that collar and access the bearing is to force it off the half shaft using a rare special field tool.
Steve, can I borrow you for a minute? I want to use this bad boy. OK, so that's the tool now clamped to the hub. Steve, if you steady it with that. I will wind some pressure on by turning this giant Acme screw at the top, and as I do that, it puts pressure onto the collar that's retaining the bearing down in the hub. It's tight.
The pressure I'm applying should force the tight-fitting collar up the half shaft, freeing the wheel bearing from the hub.
Oh, goodness me. You can't hold it, can you? You need so much pressure putting on it.
Yeah. We'll chuck it in the vise. We should be able to get some more pressure on it then, hold it a bit firmer.
Yeah, OK, yeah, yeah, let's do that. There we go. Should be the little collar. There you go. That's what this enormous tool was doing, was essentially pushing the half shaft through that collar that was pressed onto it. And now that that's out, we should be able to get the bearings out. And to do that, I'm going to turn it over and drop it into the vise. Give it a little tap from the top, and the seal and the bearing should then come out. So that is the bearing. That has got a fair amount of play in that. So that definitely needs changing. Wow, that was a lot of work. And I'm only halfway there, but now that I know the process, I can do the same to the other side. I want to get the axle casing shot blasted and repainted before I put it all back together.
Steve has confirmed my earlier suspicions about our Landy's wheels not being genuine Series 1, and so Mike's going to have to find us some originals from somewhere.
But then we'll have a genuine rebuilt Series 1 rear axle.
While Elvis has been away, I've been digging deeper into our Landy's past, something that fella who sold it to us never got round to doing.
You're back. Yeah. How was Shropshire?
Check this out. I was able to replace the oil seals, I've done the bearings and given it a good lick of paint. So look, our genuine Series 1 rear axle is good to go.
That's really good news. I've got some good news. I've been waiting for you to come back because I've got this envelope.
Oh, what's in there?
This is the heritage certificate.
Oh, exciting.
So I don't even know what it's going to say. I can't get my hands on it. It's like being at the award ceremony. And the winner is a Land Rover. Ooh, look, proper Series 1, 86-inch. How good is that?
Brilliant.
Colour, grey. It was grey.
That's an unusual colour, isn't it?
I've seen these in grey. They look absolutely wicked in grey, so I'm pleased about that. Oh, look where it went. Horton Down, Salisbury.
That's the chemical weapons research place, Porton Down.
Yeah, so I hope you've been washing your hands.
Well, I'm pretty sure it's been cleaned once or twice since then, so we should be all right. But, I mean, that's fascinating, because that kind of providence, now knowing what the history of the vehicle is, must add value to it, right?
It will, and not only that, it sort of solves the mystery, hasn't it? Because we can now work out that it left the production line in 1954. It then went to the chemical research establishment for 10 years, till 1964, when they kicked it into Sibby Street. Then it gets registered by the DVLA. That's why it's registered at the time of Series 2.
Yeah, that's it. Mystery solved, isn't
Mystery
it?
Mystery solved. Fantastic. That well, now we know. Brilliant. It's
that
brilliant.
Is brilliant.
Click here to subscribe.